Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Andrew Gough, and I'm absolutely delighted to share with you what I call the hidden hive of history, the forgotten god of the ancients. So with respect to that forgotten god, you know, there's been many gods and goddesses, and there's been lots of species of animals that have been revered. And what if I were to tell you that of the over 10 million species of insects, that there's one species that has been as revered, that's been as worshipped and held to be as sacred as any god or goddess that's ever been, and which the embodiment of it is the world's most famous megalith. Sounds pretty fantastic, and I believe that is, in fact, the bee, and specifically the honeybee, and in particular, the queen bee. So I believe that any real sacred symbol had its origins in very basic, fundamental contribution to society, such as the bee. So why is this venerated? Honey for medicinal, ritualistic, health, commerce, alcohol, all these different functions. Pollinating. Without pollinating, the world would be a totally different place. The Chinese tried to employ more people and more power to them. 26 people required to do the job of one bee for pollinating. Chinese also introduced the practice of using the bee stinger for acupuncture, which is still used today. And wax. So the Catholic Church uses beeswax for its candles, but effigies in the ancient world were really important, as we'll discuss. Propolis, this really magical regurgitated honey that's used to strengthen the immune system. But more than anything, what the ancients were inspired by were the bees as role models. And sure enough, our modern religion, politics, communism, Freemasonry, regularly orderly society, those mantras come from observing life in the hive. So bear with me as we kind of delve into prehistory, and not much is known in prehistory. That's why, hence the name, right? But we're going to come out the other side into ancient Egypt, and it'll be really clear, very demonstrable, just why and how this diminutive creature has been held sacred. But we'll give it our best shot in prehistory as well. So bees over 100 million years old have been found petrified in amber, as though immortalized in their own honey. And that fact alone made them special to the ancients, especially when amber was as valuable as gold in many places in the ancient world. Honey hunting is one of the original hunter-gatherer activities. And here you can see on a cave wall, 15,000-year-old mural showing man risking life and limb to gather honey for all the reasons we've just discussed. Same practice today in Nepal and other parts of the world. So if this little creature is as venerated as any other god or goddess that's ever been, then why don't we see it in prehistory? Well, these are all images that one scholar or another has identified as either being a bee or a bee goddess. And when I say bee goddess, I mean sometimes mythical, but usually a real woman, esteemed in society, a priestess. Today they go by the names of Melissas, nymphs. Those are all signs that we're talking about a revered prophetess woman. But sometime around 8,000 BC, it looks like, the mother goddess, the oldest archaeological deity, these statues here, that's 25,000 BC. But come about 8,000 BC, they start to get colored orange and yellow, laden with honey. The bee goddess is morphing into... The mother goddess is morphing into the bee goddess, the queen bee. Some of these other images, like this one from Neolithic Spain, show this funny-looking creature dancing, and that is because of this, the waggle dance. And Plato knew about the waggle dance. He wrote about it, and I believe the ancients knew about it as well. The fact that a bee can leave its hive and go 5 kilometers away, find food, come back, dance for the rest of the hive, and they all say, cheers, thank you, I now know where to go find that food, thank you for that satellite navigation. Many of the images of goddesses in this era and all eras are dancing, and we'll see that may have its origins in the bee's waggle dance. Usually, a giveaway that you're looking at a bee goddess is a skirt with horizontal stripes, oftentimes six or seven levels or stripes, because that's the number of levels in the bee's abdomen, and typically they're colored yellow and black. For now, think the Egyptian headdress. Oftentimes as well, they're in a shamanic state because honey in the ancient world, particularly in the Aegean, was hallucinogenic. So these women are off their head, and those are bees around their head, representing what it is that they're consuming. So bee goddesses, in this case, there isn't a horizontal striped shirt skirt, but there is a fish on her skirt, and we'll talk later why there's a fish on her skirt. The bee goddess is always protected by two dogs, two griffins, two lions, two big animals. You see a lot of ancient symbols here. The swastika before it became a symbol of the Nazi regime. A bull's head. Bulls and bees are intrinsically related, as we'll see. But this sort of image of that goddess is not only perhaps derivative of the dancing bee goddess, but there's another reason why her arms are in the air like that, and we'll cover that in great detail. Marjorie Gimbutas has done most of the research in that area. So we're looking at a 10,000-year-old temple wall in Australia, and it has a beehive, a honeycomb. Why? Well, we know later the Aboriginals would be devout honey hunters for all the reasons we've discussed. Eva Crane, the amazing British bee expert, beekeeper, bee archaeologist. I struggle for enough superlatives to describe her. This is Çatalhöyük in Turkey. No, it's not the same picture, but it looks like it. It's a honeycomb beehive shape on a temple wall in the most famous Neolithic settlement in the world. Right down the hall, so to speak, is this hall of bulls. And the reconstruction image you see here, I'm sure you've seen before. Bulls and bees are intrinsically related, and the shape that the horns are making is going to become a very important part of this presentation and the symbolism that we see with bees. Also in Çatalhöyük, and I wish I had left a whole full picture here, but this is a hunter in a shamanic state and also sort of running in the quest of a hunt. I argue that this is the first halo, and that halo is comprised of bees. As we go forward in the ancient world, you'll see that this is, in fact, how bees are portrayed. Also in Çatalhöyük, although this particular image is from Minoan Crete, and later we'll find out that the DNA is exactly the same, the DNA from Çatalhöyük and Minoan Crete, so that's where they migrated to. But the archaeologists in Çatalhöyük recognized that the double axe, which is a real physical axe with a blade on each side for ritualistic slaughter of bulls, supposedly, is portrayed at Çatalhöyük in such a way that it looks like a butterfly. And I find that fascinating because in Minoan Crete, the double axes look like bees. There are only three living creatures who can procreate without a male participant. Parthenogenesis, the bee, that creature, the butterfly, and women. And goddesses in the ancient world had the title Parthenogen in their title. There's a fantastic PhD out of San Francisco who has done this research. And it's just interesting that in the earliest of epochs, ancient man appears to have known that fact. Or at least that is what is suggested. James Mellart, who excavated Çatalhöyük. So fast forward a little bit in time. We're still around 3000 BC, and now we're in Malta, whose ancient name in Greek means honey, and Malta has the bees with by far the largest abdomens. So that's interesting, but why do we care? We care because this is what we find on Malta, are huge goddesses. Here we see a temple where there's niche facades where you would put sacred statues to the gods. No, I'm making that up. That's an apiary. That's a bee factory. That's a honey factory. 2,000 years old. So here's the most famous temple on Malta. And what do we see again? No one ever talks about this. There's a honeycomb design there. I did a radio program recently, and a woman contacted me to say she had just been to Malta, and she's not at all spiritual or esoteric, but she was in this temple, and she was just stopped in her tracks, and she had a vision. And the vision was that in the old days, there were women who were kept in their own, and her words, not mine, honeycomb hive cell, and they were adorned, and they were just fed constantly, and they got to be too big to leave their honeycomb cells, and the goal was for them to produce the largest possible children that they could. Just a really interesting sort of shamanic vision to have while in a place like this, when this is what you find around the island. So if this is 3000 BC, what happens around 3000 BC? So this is 2012, of course, and it's the alleged end of the Mayan calendar, but what interests me far more is the start of their calendar, 313, that area, sort of 3100 BC, and that's when the entire world has records of a biblical flood, or a flood, localized, or one great flood. It's hard to say, but what would have caused that? There are several things that could have caused floods all around the world. Certainly one of them would have been meteorites. So what happens at this time is people start building pyramids. And these pyramids don't have a pointy top. They're zargonauts. They're step pyramids. And why wouldn't you? Because you've just been decimated by a flood. And next time there's a flood, you're going to have some place for your religious elite to go. And of course you would start a new calendar, because life as you know it has just ended. So dynastic Egypt's a great example of that, because the founders of the Nile Valley appear to have come from Mesopotamia. Now, I've been in the eastern desert east of Luxor, and this is what you find are these drawings on the rock art, now dried up riverbeds called wadis. And they're literally dragging their boat because they've come from Samaria and there's no water here, but they're going to someplace where there is, i.e. the Nile Valley. I argue, and I've not heard this before, that that is a beehive, and this could be inspired by the bees' plumes. This will all make more sense when we look at some of the images from ancient Egypt. But this, just to preview what this is about, this is protection against the evil eye. The evil eye in the ancient world was very real. Honey harvesting was extremely important. So you're bestowing good luck and protection on your honey harvest. Take, for example, the world's most famous flood hero, Noah. The first thing Noah does after this arduous journey, the Bible tells us, is respectfully, he needs a drink. He plants a vineyard. And shortly thereafter, he's found off his head in his tent. He couldn't even make it to his bed. The ancient word for swarm is the same as the ancient word for grape. And I wonder if there isn't other sort of similar mistranslations, because to me, you'd be traveling with bees. Bees are fundamental to your existence. Civilizations that knew that flourished, those who didn't perish. So what if Noah wasn't planting a vineyard, but he was harvesting the honey? And what if he was having some of that honey, which is hallucinogenic? Even if he was having wine, it was probably mead and would have included some honey. But what this slide says, forgive me, is the bees in Egypt came from Mesopotamia, just like the people did. So this is the eastern desert, now all dried and, barren wadis. And this is the chap who's the god of the eastern desert. Yeah, an erect penis and these plumes are his fertility symbols, and aptly so, because his title is the master of the wild bees. And this is what we find is this rock art with these plume-like figures, which is quite interesting, but we also find these boats. Now, I argue these are all beehives. And there's all kinds of beehives. There's portable ones, like you see here. There's vertical, horizontal, clay, mud, natural, all different kinds of beehives. And the animals are protection. Good luck for the honey harvest. And there's French explorers who have written extensively about the fact that in the 1600s, when they were in Egypt, they would put a portable hive in a boat and go up and down the Nile, because plants in the north and the south flower at different times, so you want to maximize your honey harvest, and you would do that all year long, and the boats look something like that. So am I imagining all this, or is there any real evidence that bees were venerated in the most incredible civilization that we have a historical record of? Well, the whole region around the pyramids, Alexandria, the Delta, is called the land of the bee, Tabiti. The pharaoh's title was beekeeper. How come no one talks about that? And he of the sedge, which is a flowering plant, and the bee. So what a great symbolic title to have this sort of symbiotic relationship between the bee and the flower that it pollinates. Seer of the honey was a title in the Old Kingdom, and overseer of the beekeepers in the Middle Kingdom. Bee is pictured in every pharaoh's cartouche from the middle of the First Dynasty onwards. This is Hatshepsut. She is on record as of calling her country her bee people. So bees are all over Egypt once you start to see them. And here's the sedge, that flowering water plant, and here's the bee. Look at those plumes. By the way, they never really show the feet as being the proper 6 feet, and the first images of the bee in the First Dynasty cartouches are really comical and have one leg or maybe two legs, and they add more as they go. But 2400 BC, the art of beekeeping is fully formed. Absolutely, in these tombs, you can see it's not an art, it's a science. And they're already blowing smoke. Here's the dynasty of Akhenaten. So the salesman was blowing smoke when he told me it would last more than 6 months. You know, that's where that phrase comes from, is blowing smoke into the hive to sedate the bees so you can extract the honey. And as we'll see, that originated in Egypt. Going on to the 26th dynasty, it's even more of an art form. But the bees in Egypt were known for being the most aggressive and nasty bees anywhere in the world. So forget the protective clothing. You had to be naked, head shaved, and hope for the best, really. So hence, you would come up with this technique of blowing smoke just to make sure you weren't stung repeatedly. But I was in the British Museum just a couple weeks ago, and I saw this figure of the chap, the last native king of Egypt in the 30th dynasty. And I wonder if this isn't a beekeeper. And I wonder, since his title is Bee King, is that a honeycomb or even a natural hive that's in his hands? So I also wonder if incense derives from blowing smoke into the hive. I think it does. We know it came from Egypt and it used honey, and we can see that extracting honey from a hive is a very sacred and ritual activity. So it seems to me like that would be the case. No, that's not Akhenaten. That's a wax effigy of Michael Jackson. We still use beeswax today, but in the past we created effigies with beeswax. So if you created an effigy of somebody you wanted something bad to happen to, you would use beeswax and then you would manipulate it, and the belief was that whatever you did would happen to the person that the effigy represents. We know that Alexander the Great, whose body we've never found, is said to be buried with honey. Herodotus tells us that that's not unusual. The Babylonians did that as well. So we're at a conference that's all about megaliths. Stone circles are a big part of that. How come we never hear of a god or goddess that's associated with stone circles? So I'm just going to offer some food for thought on that question. Ra, of all the Egyptian gods, they actually ranked them 1 through 15, and the top god is Ra. So he's Lord of the circles, he who entereth in the circle, the sender forth of light in his circle, governor of his circle. So that's interesting. What else do we know? Well, stone circles are seldom round. And I know this group in particular understands there's good astrological and observational reasons why that probably is the case. But speaking of Egypt, where in the last 10 years, naphtha play has become a very big conversation, this stone circle, excuse me, it's nowhere near round. Same with this sort of timber henge and just a random collection of other British stone circles that, well, they don't represent a circle to me. They look more like a teardrop, like a tear. And God, Ra is the god of circles. He's also the god who cried bees as tears. Left eye lunar, right eye solar, masculine, and feminine all in one. So what else we know about Ra? Well, we know that his mom, the goddess Neit, lived in a place called Sais. And Sais, she had the house of the bee. We know from Herodotus that it was an amazing place. And we know from him and others that on the entrance was this incredible expression, I am all that has been, that is, that will be. No mortal has yet been able to lift the veil that covers me. Well, what might that mean? Neit was known as the veiled goddess before Isis. Bees are often called hymen uptera, stemming from the word hymen, meaning the reproductive organ of a woman's body or the holy of holies of a temple. So all of a sudden, it's taking on a different potential meaning. A lot of scholars have said that the goddess Neit is one and the same with Athena. And I love the quote here that says that the reason why Sais, which is in the Delta, in Ta-Biti, land of the bee, was so coveted. And during the first dynasty and onwards, the kings would go on pilgrimages there. Why? There was nothing there. But this comment here that Athena built Sais before the flood that destroyed Athens and Atlantis. So there's nothing in Atlantis, nothing in Athens, 9,000, 10,000 BC, nothing. This is telling me that Atlantis is a lot more recent than we give it credit for, which I'll elaborate on. So Sais was built before the flood and actually survived the flood. That's why it's special. And this Athena and this goddess Neit appears to be quite possibly one of the Mesopotamian flood heroes. Speaking of Mesopotamian flood heroes, Osiris is buried in Sais behind Neit's house of the bee in the mansion of the bee. His symbols are the white crown of Egypt. Now, of all the burials that have ever been found of pharaohs, they've never found a white crown. That's because it's biodegradable. It's a beehive. And Osiris, like so many of the gods of Egypt, come from Mesopotamia. So do we have any evidence for a link for a similar looking shape? Well, we do in Susa. So the white crown, and I've run this past Egyptologists, including David Roll, and they approve and like this. So that's the white crown. The red crown, there's only two crowns, was known as DSRT, and Budge translated it as Deshert. The Jardite tradition, which we'll talk about, because at the time of the Tower of Babel, which is allegorical for the time of the flood, according to the Mormon tradition, the Jardites got in their boat with bees, dragged it across ancient lands to America. We'll look at that some more. But in the Jardite language, it's Deseret. So could it be the red crown, bee, and the white crown, hive, eternal knowledge, were all about bees? It appears as though they could have been. Now, Sais is also special because it's the only place that we get any knowledge of Atlantis. So Solon, who went to be one of the great seven sages in about 500 BC, he goes to Sais and the priests tell him about this great civilization now perished that existed 9,000 years before. Solon goes back and actually institutes laws in Athens about beekeeping. You have to keep beehives certain number of meters away from each other. But A couple hundred years later, Plato writes about this account of Solon's. But then 300 years later, this philosopher Crator says, I don't believe a word of it. I'm going to Sais. He does. They tell him the same story. How many people have actually been to Egypt? Well, that's at least half. Have we ever seen pillars or reliefs that talk about great ancient cultures that weren't Egyptian? I don't know of any. I've been all over. So I believe those priests were telling the truth, but they were counting in lunar years, which was quite common. Every month is a year. If you do that math, the 9,000 lunar years before the time of Solon is right at 1100 BC when the greatest devastation in the ancient world occurred, the eruption of Thera and Minoan Crete, which I believe was Atlantis and contemporaneous and friendly with the Egyptians, was destroyed. And the amazing thing about Sais is that's where the Rosetta Stone comes from. Yeah, they found it in Rosetta, but they had moved it to Rosetta from Sais. So the place that gives us the key to any idea about Atlantis also is the only place that gives us the key to unlock the language of the greatest ancient civilization ever. So I believe Santorini is Atlantis, and we'll talk about that some more. Brief detour on diversion, if you will, on bulls, because they're also quite important and related to bees. So Apis in Latin means bee, spelled backwards is sepa, and there's our first clue as to the importance of the bull, sepa meaning great shepherd in the sky. Taurus is Latin for bull. The genus of the honeybee is Apis, and many Greek gods embody the bull, whether it be Apis or just in general. Herodotus tells us, no, it was special bulls, black ones with a white disc and these special marks on the forehead. Those are the only ones that were important. They were the Apis. Well, the cult of Apis goes way back because that's what was in the night sky, 4530 approximately. And like the Apis bull, the constellation has stars in the forehead. So we can kind of see what's coming here. The six-tiered Mesopotamian step pyramid in Saqqara, just a few hundred meters away from that, Marietta in 1851 discovers this, which is a Apis bull necropolis. And he discovers it because he finds bull horns in the sand. Now, we know from this philosopher in 250 BC that in Egypt, if you bury an ox in certain places so that only the horns project above ground and saw them off, they say that bees fly out. Well, if you dig a little deeper, so to speak, the mythology says that 1,000 bees are born out of the carcass of a dead bull and they become souls. So that's interesting. This is sounding a bit like Mithraism, of which we know very little. There are 7 tiers for an initiate, sacred meals, secret handshakes, and ritualistic slaughter of bulls. So it's believed to be something that came from ancient Rome or maybe even Persia. I think its origins are in Egypt. And here's a picture of the ritualistic slaughter of a bull. Again, 1,000 bees are supposed to be born when that happens. But this mythology of killing a bull or a big, big creature and having bees come forth has been preserved in some really unusual ways. Lyell's Golden Syrup, which is from the book of Judges in the Bible, the story of Samson, and this famous riddle, what is sweeter than honey, what is stronger than a lion, and bees coming out of its body. Sadly, this cult of bull killing exists today. Many of the bull rings in Spain are built over Mithras temples. And all I can say is, poor bull, because this is an archetype. What were the ancients looking at in the night sky? They had no sky TV. This was their TV. They saw a hunter killing a bull. So, of course, you would say, what a sacred scene that is. We need to form a mystery school on the ground and act out that play in reverence to what we see in the sky. It makes perfect sense. There are many archetypes. Mithraism, I believe, is one of them. And at this time, you have the Epic of Gilgamesh talking about the same thing, the killing of a bull. You have all the images at Saqqara, which is contemporaneous with the Epic of Gilgamesh, about 2400 BC, all about killing a bull because that's what they saw in the night sky. We'll come back to bulls, but I just want to look at some imagery now and kind of ease into what conclusions we might or might not be able to draw. Can we say that these Egyptian plumes may have been inspired by those sorts of images? It's a bit speculative, but worth considering. You gotta give me this. If that's a bee goddess, according to scholars, and that's a bee, and his title is the beekeeper, and he lives in the land of the bee, and he's wearing yellow and black horizontal stripes on his death mask, it's not rocket science. I believe that is inspired by the bee for sure. Another one, which is a little bit more symbolic, but nobody can give us a good explanation for what the Jed pillar is. It's being shown, being put up to the mouth of the pharaoh in religious ceremonies in Abydos, Saqqara, the Hesed festival, the celebration of the second term, if you will, for the king. And it's associated with Osiris as well. And Osiris is a symbol of the bull's backbone as one of his symbols. And here we can see the sacrum of the bull looks a lot like the Jed pillar. And I kind of like that. But keep in mind, the Greeks who will come later, when the centurions, the chaps who lived to be 100, were asked, how would you ever live that long? They would say, honey. So I think it's a symbolic honey dripper you're putting up to the mouth of the pharaoh saying, good luck in your second term. Here, long live the king. Which is different than God save the queen. No booze, please. I know this sounds a bit sacrilegious. Was the Sphinx a bee goddess? The Sphinx was called many things by many different people. Of course it would be, because there were different languages coming in different epochs and seeing this rock-hewn statue. But thanks to a piece of 1937 research, the Minoan language, which we still don't have the key for, but we know what one word in the Minoan language is, and it's their word for bee, S-P-H-E-X. The Greeks, who learn all their beekeeping from the Minoans, march into Cairo, and they named this Sphinx. They're the ones who named it Sphinx. The Egyptians called it Hunab. I think that's amazing. So when you look at the fact that there's, in the pyramid text and other texts, there's supposed to be two gods, two dogs who protect, or two lions that protect the Sphinx, one on either side. And that's led some people to conclude there might be two Sphinxes. But I think it's interesting because Anubis is what a lot of people believe the Sphinx is, and that's a dog. But if you look at the images of Anubis, there's bees on its skin, which is kind of interesting. And right at the time when the Greeks name the Sphinx, and this is the word meaning bee in Minoan, we start to see these images around the Mediterranean. Interesting. So that's the first half of the golden age of the bee veneration is ancient Egypt. Minoan Crete is the second half, but we're going to take a little bit of a detour to Rome and go a little bit more current before we go back in time. So it's 350 BC, you're in Rome, meteorites are pelting the countryside. So in a time of national crisis, you do what you always did, you consult the Sibylline text, these oracle utterances written by a bee goddess known as a Sibyl. And they say, bless you, they say, that's not good. Create a day of reverence for this god. So they do. But now, it's 200 years later, and the meteorites return, and Rome is losing the war. So they consult the Sibylline text again, and they say, oh, not good at all. You have to go get the mother goddess. She lives in Anatolia. Her name's Cabella. She's a bee goddess, and she's also a meteorite. So that's what they do. But Cabella comes with her own priesthood. Priesthood who dresses in yellow and wears a big, high turban sort of hat, and they castrate themselves. And castration becomes a craze within Rome. And Rome says, stop that. You can't mutilate yourself. It's against the law. Stop castrating. But they do, especially on the Feast of the Blood every 24th of March. And what I think is interesting is that this, if Cabella is a bee goddess, she's a goddess of bees in caves, let's look at the analogy in the bee world. The drone, who has no stinger and has sex with the bee, the queen, and the queen only has sex when the sun is out, so this year the queen wouldn't have had much sex at all. So the queen goes as close to the sun as possible. And the drones follow her up there, have sex with her, and then they're not allowed back in the hive if they die. So it's symbiotic of the relationship between the meteorite, the megalith, Cabella, and her priesthood. But what is the most revered stone of all time? The one in Mecca. So the one, Cabella disappears from the historical record around 300 AD. What reappears around that time? The most adored stone, Kaaba, not a million miles from Cabella. And contrary to what people think, this is not the worship of a god, it's the worship of a goddess. And they used to have seven priestesses encircling the stone seven times naked. The priests who castrate themselves are known as sons of the old women. So the bee goddess is right there in the ancient world, any other god or goddess, and may embody the most worshipped megalith in the history of this planet. And in ancient Arabian religions and many ancient religions, there seems to be a memory. Remember the flood 3000 BC? People would have seen that. They would have remembered. They survived it. Meteorites, gods from heaven rocked our world. And what does Parsifal talk about? Eschenbach writes about the first ever grail. Well, it's a stone from heaven. Curiously, the word meteorite in the Kabbalah carries the same numeric value, 443, as the Egyptian word for B, which is bit. So B, meteorite, are the same in the Kabbalah. Seems to be some memory. And in Anatolia, where the mother goddess, the bee goddess, is from, real stiff penalties from the Hittites if you were to steal honey. And this is where the word Melissa comes from. So kind of moving back now to the second half of the golden age of bee veneration, we're now on Crete, and Marjorie Gimbutas has telling us that while these kind of images are real common, arms up in the air, horns on the head, griffins on both sides, this is a bee goddess. So the capital of Minoan Crete, which I'm arguing is the capital of Atlantis, this is the palace of the double axe, the palace of Kenosis, excavated by Arthur Evans, me next to the horns of consecration, Icarus, who could have been symbolically a drone bee himself because he dies when he goes too close to the sun because his beeswax wings melt. That took place on Crete. Lots of bull symbolism, shamanic dancing, and of course the labyrinth of Kenosis. And we have these huge jars which archaeologists try to determine what used to be in them, and they never mention honey, even though the king's son, King Menos, his son, we know, died in a vat of honey. And this vat's taller than I am. So we have a text which talks about the mistress of the labyrinth, who is the most holy. And it says, to the gods honey, to the mistress of the labyrinth, the most honey. It's because that's a bee. The labyrinth is a hive. There is no labyrinth. Just like Huwara in Egypt is not a labyrinth, it's an administrative center. Now, there are labyrinths, like the one in the Florashar Cathedral, which we find down the road in Rock Valley outside of Tintagel as well. Those are real labyrinths. There wasn't one in Crete. I'll submit to you and I'll show you why. This is where the rituals would take place. It's the bull leaping court. And this is the bull leaping ritual. These images go back to Avaris in Egypt, where the Exodus started from, and before that, northern Syria. And before that, 20, 30,000 years ago in the caves in France, you see these bulls with these young men kind of just leaping around them. And here we have sort of feminine looking figures throwing a chap over the bull in sort of an act of, I can do this incredibly defiant act. No one knows what it represents, but I look at this elongated bull, and for me, it mirrors Crete itself. Here are the horns, and it just seems to be an interesting sort of similarity. By the way, we know the date of this because this frame is very unique, and on the mainland, it dates to a very specific time, and it's around 1100 BC. So, two things to notice. One, the bull is crying. Why is the bull crying? And is this where the expression taking the bull by the horns comes from? I think it might be. No one knows who these figures are. I argue that this figure who's taken the bull by the horns is the same figure who takes the bull by the horns in mythology takes it from Crete back to Greece. That was Hercules. And if this is Hercules, then these could be the pillars of Hercules. And I'm speculating now. I'm speculating. And if that was the pillars of Hercules, then for me, it would satisfy every element necessary for Crete to be Atlantis, because the pillars of Hercules, the Straits of Gibraltar, create a problem for Atlantis being Crete. But this could be an explanation. So the horns of consecration, bulls, these incredible fertility symbols. They say that's why they have this incredible horns of consecration, but every single temple and building has them, as you see here. That is the shape used for protection against the evil eye. The Minoans, no one knows where they got their money from. My argument is they were the drug lords of the Aegean. They're growing poppies, it's a fact. Poppies, a huge abundance of poppies. And poppies is where opium comes from, it's a fact. That's where heroin comes from. And you have honey that's hallucinogenic. And you're living in a huge honey factory. So you have all this symbolism to say, please protect the honey. Now bear with me on this. In Greece, where the evil eye started, they harvest honey at night because they're afraid of the evil eye. So if you're the drug lords of the Aegean and you're sending out these cocktails to Egypt, to Rome, to everywhere, and I'll show you that there's evidence that that was happening, then that's your livelihood. That is your life. So you're going to have this form of protection, which, oddly enough, world leaders use indiscriminately. I'm not sure what's going on there. I just found it a bit curious that the same expression's been preserved by these notables. So protection against the evil eye. If this is a goddess, that's a goddess, that's a god. Oh, by the way, the reason there's a fish on her dress is that ancient times, if you were wet, you were more protected from the evil eye. If you were dry, the evil eye could get you. And here we have two of these large lions, perhaps, protecting a pillar. Why a pillar? Well, a pillar is an irminsul in Old Saxon, and they were in Northern Europe, mostly Germany. Charlemagne thought they were pagan, so he destroyed them. Here's me looking at one in not far from Wevelsburg. But this is one that I believe that Carl Marie Vieugot created to make it appear as though the area around Wevelsburg was more ancient and Aryan than it was, because that's what they were trying to do at that time. But let's look at the definition of an irminsul. The oldest definition of irminsul is a tree trunk erected in the open air. That's a beehive. So this is an irminsul. Actually, the irminsul would go in there. So that's a tower, and we have these towers in Scotland, Ireland, and Iberia. By the way, again, here's the open-air beehive. That's a definition of an irminsul. And you'd have this open-air trunk in case bees would swarm. They'd have a place to go. Bees swarm when the new queen is taking control, and she takes half of the bees with her, and the other half stay. But these towers, which are all over Iberia, Ireland, and Scotland, no one knows what they're for. They're not domestic, they're not for storage, they're not for fortresses, not defensive, rather, and they're always, or almost always, on the water. But now we find coins with trees coming out of the towers. So what if this could have been some sort of safe haven for bees to swarm to or to stop them from swarming? So, again, Crete is all about drugs. The ancient world, don't kid yourself, it's all about drugs. It's the fastest way for you to commune with your gods. And opium, heroin, no one talks about the fact that these goddesses have poppies on their head. And they're in a shamanic state. They're off their head. Here we have the famous snake goddess, but six-tiered horizontal yellow-black skirt, but she's holding the snake. So how does that relate to a bee? Well, the Sanskrit word for opium is snake foam. So it's all about the drugs. And we have all of these famous Greek gods who die and go to the underworld and come back. I'm not buying it. They're doing heroin with hallucinogenic honey. And there's some other images of sort of snake goddesses. So if Crete is Atlantis, I would expect to see things like this, the famous disc that we can't even begin to decipher that appears to be a calendar, but who knows? The only word we know is their word for bee. And they have all these signets and seals, thousands of them used for royalty. Here's one of the bull leaping. But here's one, a fantastic piece of long-forgotten research from 1958 where the expert beekeepers got in a room with the expert historians and they said, right, let's have a go at this. So the beekeepers said, well, there's the hive. There's two hives. Here are the earminsels. Horns of consecration, which are saying protect us from from the evil eye in our honey harvest. Here is the bee priestess with this horizontal striped skirt. She's holding this stick, which is what you did in ancient times. You'd bang it against a mound to stop the bees once they swarmed, to stop them from swarming. She's protected by two lionesses, and these are natural beehives. Let's look at another. No one's ever offered an explanation for these. So we have a tower with a tree in it, a woman who appears to be in a shamanic state, bending it down to extract the hives, some of which are already on the ground. There's two or three instances of that. Little bees all around. They're in a shamanic state because it's highly hallucinogenic. Here's a boat with an altar. No, it's a beehive. And a shamanic state person in that boat. This is what that looks like today, bending a tree down to extract honey from the trees. But look at this. This is a miniature that the Minoans made of their own boats, ceramic miniature. They're the drug lords of the Aegean. They're taking this concoction all over the ancient world. There's only one side effect. You go blind. And Akhenaten goes blind. And all the seer priestesses at Delphi go blind. So it makes me wonder, we talked about Noah, could there be a corruption of the word, because grape and swarm was the same word. Dionysus is the god of wine. It looks a lot like honey, given what we just saw. And again, honey in that wine in that age would have had honey in it anyways. So it's just food for thought, as is the fact that the Minoan beehives were wooden and had two poles. So I'm not saying the Ark of the Covenant was a beehive, but Ethiopians believe that the bee once defended the throne of God. The throne of God is the Ark of the Covenant. And these figures here are the daughters of the God who cried bees as tears, whose mom lived in the house of the bee. So if Kenosis is the palace of the double axe, let's just look at that. The double axe, the word for that is labrys. That's where the word labyrinth comes from. That's why everyone thinks there's a magnificent labyrinth in Kenosis. I don't think so. That's a real physical axe. That looks like a bat. Here's one that's in the horns of a bull. Quite feminine there, suckling a flower here, on top of a pillar here. There's many examples of just how feminine these double axes look. It's because they're bees. It's a bee factory. It's a honey factory. They're the drug lords of the Aegean. And so if Kenosis is the palace of the double axe, and that's where the word labyrinth comes from, then we're talking about Kenosis being the palace of the bee. And in 1958, they concluded that the double axe was a bee, just like in Napoleon's time, Napoleon and his entire court knew that the fleur-de-lis was a bee. And so if that's a hive, and the legends of Atlantis have these circular sort of, I can't think of the right word, but the legends of Atlantis have these big circular mounds. You know, could it have been a memory of a beehive? Because it's a honey factory, Kenosis. And the Minoan style, the thin waist, the incredibly thin waist of the bee, the abdomen. And this is the six-tiered horizontal stripe. And look at these, very famous. The prince of Kenosis, bees. Those are bees. Just interesting that that's mirrored in art as well. Now, still on Crete, one of the most incredible finds of the Bronze Age is this figure, which is found in this so-called cemetery right near the ocean. So here's a close-up of it, and here's what it looks like. Now, what is that doing in a cemetery? It's an altar. It's not a tomb, but that's where they found this. And I could go on for 20 minutes about just the different theories by scholars on this. Not one of them mentions that you have an opium cage. again, it's all about drugs. And you have this particular kind of regurgitated honey that they carried on their feet only in Crete. But look at where it is. I don't believe it's a cemetery at all. This is Thera. This is where the eruption that ends Atlantis occurs. But it's not one earthquake. In fact, a long time before this, the archaeology shows that they were doing a ritual. They were killing a young boy when the earthquake hit, Poseidon, the earthshaker, and wiped out Minoan Crete, or wiped out Crete. It wasn't Minoan then. So the earthshaker returns, and they're like, uh-oh, not good. Second one occurs. We don't know the exact date, but it could be as short in duration as all three within 25 years, or it could be 100 years. But it's basically around a generation or two. The bull is crying because the bull gets painted at this time. They know their days are numbered. In fact, they put their priest in boats and they send them out. One of them, historically, we know ends up in Delphi, where the legend is bees built the second temple at Delphi. But I believe that this was where they were doing human sacrifices to Poseidon, the earthshaker. They were great seafarers. They would have known that directly north where the tsunamis were hitting was Thera. So they're doing blood sacrifices there. And this is what they manufactured. And remember when Marietta finds the bullhorns in the sand and they're cut off? Well, that's what these are. But look, you have to put them in a stand. What a cumbersome thing. But there's three palaces on Crete. They each have a king. Two of those kings go on to share the responsibility of being judges of souls in Hades. And I think that they are actually doing sacrifices to stop the earthshaker, Poseidon, from ending their world like he has before. So you move into Delphi. The second temple was built by bees. The priests are called men of the double axe, which is double axe is a bee, so men of the bee. So you have the Delphic bee, on and on. But look at the oracle stone, the most famous megalithic oracle stone in the world. Not only does it have crisscrossing bees on it, it looks just like a beehive, because that's what it is. And today, if you go to Delphi, and you wonder why there aren't any beehives, natural beehives around, is they knock them down to this day because they're ridiculously hallucinogenic. If you went and put your hand in and tasted the honey, you would trip. So you have these honeycomb hive-shaped tombs. Now, the DNA of the people who are doing this, this is from Crete, is identical to the DNA of the people from Catalhoyuk. They migrated. And here we have Wevelsburg, Nazi Germany. Himmler created this under the North Tower. You can see the walls are still stained from the rituals they did there. But these bee huts are everywhere in the ancient world. Rennes-le-Château, Ireland, Africa. Every culture has bee gods and goddesses if you just look for them. And in the Mayan world, appropriately, they're called the savior god. They have no female gods. It's just the savior god who's male. This is the place in Mexico on the water where the bee god first appears. But look at this. No one ever comments on the fact that the Mayan have their own bull-leaping fresco. So the boat of priests that went from Crete to Delphi, they sent boats all directions, so we're told. So what if one came to South America? It's consistent with some of their legends. But look, we have this figure here that looks a bit like the bee god. We have these trees with sort of honey potential hives in them, and two pyramids, and some sort of star, and an erminsul as well. So the symbolism is just incredible. Also at this time, so the Battle of Troy follows the earthquakes, the tsunamis that was Thera erupting. And the Battle of Troy follows that very closely, maybe 70 years later. So that battle is about trade. What if the trade was drugs? What if the ancient world couldn't get their fix? Well, 100 years later, no more, in Israel, the land of milk and honey, they create this honey factory of 100 hives, because they have to build their own honey now, manufacture their own honey now for some reason. But look at the apiary, I just discovered this last year or 2 years ago, has a four-horned altar, erminsuls, horns of consecration, with figures of naked fertility goddesses and an elaborately painted chalice. So tell me that honey harvesting is not an important ritualistic event. So just to kind of summarize the bee and megalomania, there is the greatest oracle stone in the world, bees outside of a beehive. The mother goddess was a bee, a meteorite. Bee in Egyptian is bit, same value as a meteorite, which relates it to the Grail, the Oracle Stone, and even Rhea, who is the counterpart of Kabbalah in Crete, feeds stones to save her son from being eaten by her husband, who's eating all the kids. So a long legacy. There's a picture of it. So going into the early church, Jesus was the ethereal bee. Essenes were called king bees. Christ had honey as the first thing he ate after the resurrection. And honey is mentioned 61 times in the Bible. John the Baptist survived on honey in the desert. And in 2004, this crop circle appeared not far from here. How's that for serendipity? And you can go on and on. If you go into the Vatican City today in Rome and look at the statues of the popes, there's not like a big hat they have on. It is a hive with the stripes and the entrance to the hive. It's a beehive. So the oldest example in the Bible of poetry is the Song of Deborah. Deborah in Hebrew is D-B-R-E. Deborah means bee. So the Song of the Bee is the most ancient poem in the Bible. And she fits a bee goddess, which is like a warrior princess. Think of that sort of character, those sorts of characteristics, and that's what you get. The sound of the bee is heard during changes in consciousness, so near-death experiences, alien abductions, yoga. All the people who were around Lourdes and Fatima, not the kids who were seeing all the apparitions, but everyone around them when the second and third apparitions happened, the witnesses all said, "We heard bees." They didn't say, "But we heard a buzzing sound." They said, "We heard bees." So that's quite interesting. So moving into Europe, where we're at today, this is the Beekeeper's Island. Glastonbury is used to be an island. Of course, I walked around the Abbey yesterday, and sort of as you're heading towards the tour and the trees there, there's some hives to this day. And right down the street here in Wells Cathedral, 3 years ago, those bees swarmed and formed a cross right there in front of Wells Cathedral. And many examples. France is one of my favorites because they actually recognize that their country is shaped like a honeycomb. And they were proud of that. They acknowledged that. And we talked about the fleur-de-lis being a bee, which now gives it new meaning when you see it in things like churches and in Bretagne, the dancers wore beehive hats. Even during the Revolution, the beehive was a symbolism. Napoleon, what was his nickname? The bee. He's honoring the great Merovingian kings, the long-haired kings of France that date back supposedly to Jesus Christ and to David. Childeric is one of those kings. They found him buried with 300 gold bees, only two of which survive. And bees are all over Napoleon's reign in terms of clothing and fashion. The last grandmaster of the Priory of Sion, Pierre Plantard, had 11 bees in his family crest, along with two bearers, the natural enemy of bees, and many family crest in France depict bees, oftentimes three bees, and three bees were put into Egyptologists call them flies, but I'm pretty sure they're bees, put into the tombs of pharaohs or royals who were famous for having done something really honorable. So I think that's where the three bees comes from. There was also three archers who protected the wild bee hunters in Egypt. So going into modern day, we just had the 1st of May, right? So the 1st of May, Beltane, Day of Taurus, Labor Day, Worker Day, 1776, the most famous secret society in the history of the world was launched. And we all know that Adam Le Chouard put had a couple other names that he wanted to call this organization besides the Illuminati. But what's a little known fact is that one of them was bees, but the name was already taken by one of his enemies. So imagine what would David Icke be talking about today if the Illuminati were really called bees? So Freemasonry, this is Washington's regalia. You can see the beehive up there. Regular, orderly society comes, that whole mantra of Freemasonry comes from the bees, and they adopted the symbolism in a big way. Communism is from observing life in the hive, and this is the English cartoon of political cartoon, all allegorical for life in the hive, and the state building in New Zealand, and a really famous political meeting about 15 years ago, telling in the bees, birds and the bees, spelling bees. My favorite story of telling the bees occurred not too far from here in the 70s. So the telling of the bees goes like this. If the beekeeper dies, tell the bees right away, otherwise they'll swarm. They'll get very upset. And there was a beekeeper who sang to his bees every day. He did this. He let the bees come and rest on his body. Excuse me. He used to sing to them, loved them, they loved him, he died. It was buried 2 days later, 3 miles away, across the fields. They were having the funeral, and they stopped the funeral because someone said, look at that. All the bees were coming single file, circled around the casket, landed on the casket, and stayed. And somebody actually was so blown away by it. Everybody was blown away by it, but they went and they called the local newspaper who came and reported the story. And the bees kind of just circled around, got up, single file, and left. Winnie the Pooh is a great way of sort of propagating the whole legacy of bees and their adversaries, bearers. Bearers used to be called bee wolves, and that's where Beowulf comes from. Some of your favorite beverages, some of mine, use honey today, and some of our favorite music is influenced by the beehive. And then we have these horrible bee movies, right? And I tell a story of I've got a business job, that's my day job, and I'm making a sales call with an executive. We're waiting in the lobby for someone from a big company to come and meet us, and he just lurches across the floor and goes, and kills the bee. I'm like, why did you do that? And he said, I was afraid it would fly up and sting me. Well, he's watched too much of this. And thanks to Jerry Seinfeld, at least there's a bit of levity in some of the current bee movies, like Bee Movie, which has the great line, bees are only in it for the honey. My country has the Mormon tradition, and they named the whole western region of states here the honeybee. And the original, and you see it all over the Mormon faith, the symbol of the bee, and you can see the beehive in the original American flag. But what's amazing is their story, the Mormons, is of the Jaredites. Some scrolls were discovered a couple hundred years ago only that recount this story of the time of the Tower of Babel, which is the time of the flood. These people got in a boat with their bees and went across ancient lands like we saw in Egypt. That's where they would have gone, all the way to America with their bees. So I asked the question, does America's capital hold perhaps the key to confirming this? And the most iconic monument, I think, in the United States is this gargantuan obelisk called Washington's Monument. What does it say on the base of Washington's Monument? To our Lord, the honeybee. Is the bee the real lost symbol and the forgotten god of the ancients? I believe that it is. Thank you very much. You've been a great audience.